underlying causes of addiction. You've heard that, right? You might have even heard me say that addiction is oftentimes just a symptom of another problem. What in the world do I really mean when I say that? Well, stay tuned because we're going to take a look at that in today's video. For those of you who are new here, I'm Amber Hollingsworth. You're watching Put the Shovel Down. This YouTube channel is all about helping you understand the science and psychology of addiction so you can get your life and your family back on track and get back to living the life that you want to live. Okay, so let's get back to our topic of what are these underlying conditions? What does that really mean? I guess it could mean that you are genetically predisposed to addiction, right? That could be an underlying cause. Or I guess it could mean that you've had trauma in your past and that trauma is impacting you in such a way that's making you more vulnerable to addiction. Those are definitely things that can be underlying conditions that trigger addiction. But I'm not going to talk about those two in this specific video. I actually have videos on each of those topics and I'll link them up at the end of this one in case you want to see. In this video, I'm going to talk about unmet needs and how having unmet needs makes us so much more vulnerable to developing addiction. Now, you may have heard about those research experiments in the 50s where they put rats in these little boxes and they had them press levers and they got them all addicted to cocaine until they killed themselves on drugs, right? Well, that's actually true. That happened. And if you want to learn more about some of those rat experiments, take a look at this video because I talk in depth about that. However, today we're going to talk about another researcher that came along. In fact, this is a Canadian researcher named Bruce Alexander. Now, Bruce was looking at the old rat research. Particularly, he was looking at the old Skinner boxes. If you don't know what Skinner boxes are, they talk about it like in basic psychology. In this situation, it's a little box. In fact, the little boxes are not much more than about 3 times the size of the rat. They put the rats in there. They don't feed them for a long time. They put a lever in there. They compress it and get the reward. And guess what? All those rats got addicted. So previously, researchers took that to mean that the drug itself causes a person to become addicted. And once they become addicted, they'll do all this stuff. They won't even eat until they kill themselves. That's what the rats did, right? Well, Bruce wanted to look at that a little bit further. His research is known as the rat park studies. Because what Bruce was thinking, he's looking at these rats, they're all alone, they're in this tiny box, there's nothing else going on in there. Pretty much all they have is the lever. It's like they're in isolation and rats are made to be social, just like humans are. So Bruce decides, he thinks to himself, I wonder what would happen if I had these rats, but they weren't just like all alone in the tiny isolation box, you know? So he built this whole big thing that he called Rat Park because it's practically like Disneyland for rats. He said it's about half the size of his garage floor and there's like cool rat toys in there, other rats to play with, food, water, everything a little happy rat could need to be happy. And what Bruce did was he put 2 water bottles in the rat park containers, right? So one of those water bottles was just water. And one of those water bottles was water mixed with morphine. And what Bruce found was that when the rats pretty much had all of their other needs met, like little rat friends, little rat toys, and little rat things to do, and food, and all the things that rats need, they pretty much just drank the water. They would occasionally go over and drink the morphine, but it actually looked more like what recreational drug users look like in our society. But they didn't compulsively go to the morphine water. Now that tells us something really big, doesn't it? It tells us when we're having our needs met and we're happy and we're healthy, we're not nearly as prone to addiction. But if we're in a situation where we're lonely or we're isolated or we're feeling hopeless, we're a lot more prone to addiction because we feel so terrible. We're just not getting our needs met very well. And Bruce even took this study to another level. Because a lot of people would say, okay, Bruce, but what about if the rats were already addicted? Because once addicted, you're always addicted, right? So Bruce took it, he made a whole nother set of rats, and he got the second set of rats totally dependent on the morphine. Like, he gave them morphine for like 56 or 57 days in a row straight until they were definitely chemically dependent. You would think, okay, well, those rats are going to be addicted for the rest of their lives, right? Well, he put those rats inside the rat park. Guess what happened? For the most part, those rats went back to living normal lives. Now, it's not that they never went to the morphine water, and yeah, they had a little bit of withdrawal, but they started going back doing normal rat things and drinking mostly the regular water. It's like they started to overcome their own addiction once they were in a situation to get their own needs met. Now, obviously, that's not the whole story. Addiction is complicated, and human beings are not rats. In fact, we have this whole big giant frontal lobe thinking part of our brain, a lot bigger and stronger than rats have. Yeah, rats can learn and think, but not like humans can. But I still think there is a lot to be learned from these studies. In fact, people from the 12-step community say that the only way you can get better is from one addict helping another addict. I don't know if that's completely true, but I definitely think the community and helping people get their needs met is a huge step in the right direction. In fact, if you ask me, now I'm not a researcher, but if you ask me my opinion on it, I feel like if we did a better job of helping people that were addicted have employment, meaningful employment, that would go a long way towards helping addiction. But you know what? When people get addicted, what do? We put them in isolation, right? We throw them in jail. We kick them out of our house. We disconnect from them. We cut them off, right? Now they're like the little rats in the Skinner boxes. Do you think that's going to make them more likely to be addicted or less likely? Yeah, you're right. More likely. And not only that, they get these legal charges, which makes it where they can't get jobs. And in a lot of cases, they definitely can't get meaningful jobs, the ones that they really love and care about. So again, because of the addiction, now they're stuck not being able to get their needs met very effectively, which only sets them up further for more addiction. There's a lot to be learned from the Rat Park studies. But then again, that's just one more piece of the puzzle. There are more things that contribute to why people get addicted. In fact, and to why some people get addicted and why others don't, which is why I want you to watch this video next so that you can get the next puzzle piece.